Well, welcome. And this module, we're going to be talking about stateless design. So we're going to talk about some of the details about how that's important, especially when we're talking about applications running in Azure. And maybe to get started, though, we're going to have to discuss what is state. To understand what stateless design is, what exactly does state mean? When I think about state in an application, we'll talk about a typical web application. We're talking about the context of the user that's in that application. So why is that important to the cloud? Well, it's important to that cloud because we need to understand which servers we're going to hit whenever a user is actually browsing to the application. So if we cut to a design here, I have an architectural diagram here showing two different types of designs here. On the left side, we see what our traditional application was previous to maybe cloud or even pre-SOA type operations. And in this module, or in this mode, we basically have a website, and you can see the rectangular box here is encompassing this single website. Now, we could have multiple of these. Let's say we had four web servers over here. These all have a UI layer and a service layer that's built inside of that application. So there's a tight coupling there between the different layers in the application. Now, we have a SQL database, obviously, as our repository, and the flow would be actually up here. We probably have some sort of a load balancer in a typical application. Users are going to come into that load balancer. The load balancer is going to figure out which server. We have four servers here, which one to go to. Once it figures out what server to go to, it's going to go through the UI, down through the service layer to the database, and then ultimately return all this back to the user. Now, that's all great, and that works great if you have a single server, right? So if we had a single server, life is grand, everything works great. But when we start saying, well, now we have multiple servers, we kind of have some problems here. Because when the user actually, let me go ahead and clear this. When the user actually comes in here the first time, let's say they come into the UI layer. And when they come in, we load some stuff from the database. So we ultimately get down here, we load some stuff up, we get it back in the UI layer, we're caching it there. So now we have some context for that user. Let's say it's the username, for instance. So we're showing that in the top of the application. We have their username there. Everything's great. Now, if the next request from that user comes through the load balancer, and for some reason, and let's say we had four servers here, let's say one of those servers goes down. So now we only have three. And let's say the one that went down was the one that I was actually using. So in that case, now we're going to have a problem, right? Because when the user comes in, it's going to say, well, I don't have any context for this user, and either throw an error. So it's going to come back up here and we have bad stuff happening, like an error, or we'll have to go the whole way back and round trip to the database, which doesn't scale very well. So if we looked at a better design for how do we kind of solve that? If we look at the right side, and this is not cloud specific, but this really has relevance when you're talking about the cloud, because the cloud's all about scale and about how we can spin up multiple instances of these things. So it's not just something that you can just do on a whim, right? We have to plan for these kind of things and understand how the flow is going to be in our application.
Hey, can I ask a real quick question?
Sure.
Just before you move on there, because you were talking about the hardware load balancer on the, so is that typically an external load balancer or is that internal?
So that's a good question. The load balancer in Azure can be both. It could be either internal or external, or you can actually use both. And that's a great point, because when we talk about
splitting
the layers, we can actually put a load balancer in between like the UI layer and the
right.
service layer. So we'll show that here in a second on the diagram, but yeah, great point. So in Azure, we actually have the notion of a software load balancer. Typically, when you're on premises, you would have a hardware counterpart to do that. So if we cut back to the diagram again, and as Mark mentioned, so we have a load balancer here, but we could also have a load balancer here.
Yep.
What's great about this is now, so users can come in here. They're going to come in through the UI layer, you know, eventually they're going to get down to some data and they're going to load it back up. But the nice thing about this design is we've decoupled these layers. So now we can like scale these independently. So if we had four servers for the front end, maybe we only need two servers for the load balancer. So in this case, we're able to like kind of break that. And the key point though is around state. So to bring it back to the stateless design, we don't want to have some sort of out-of-band session management in order to pull this off. Typically in the past, what we've had is something like this. We would have the user come in, they would load up stuff, and then we had a call out here to like a state server, let's say. And that state server was holding that thing that I was talking about before, like the username and that kind of stuff that we've actually loaded up from here. So the thing is, that becomes a scalability point, right? We can't scale that. At some point, what if we have 100,000 users hitting this application? Then we have to figure out how we're going to partition that that state server in order to pull this off. But if we make our thing stateless, which basically means we just load the data that we need here, we keep our layers separated, so we have a nice decoupling here between these. This guy's separate from this guy, which is separate from this guy. So we can scale these things independently based on the need of the application. Makes it really nice. And that's, again, this isn't a cloud-specific thing. This is a specific application architecture that you should be following in order to make your application scale. You don't want to have to re-architect your application later after it becomes a success. That's the thing that I used to use when I was working with developers for scaling applications, when we talk about these state problems. It's very easy to spin up these state servers, and it takes care of the problem for you. The developer's out of it. He says, well, it'll load it from the state server, everything's fine. And then when you're a success, when you have 100,000 users, now you have a problem because you have a choke point.
So I have a question. I find it interesting because a lot of the applications I deal with are typically stateless. Now, when you're looking at that state server, is that another database, or how does that work?
Yeah, so good question. The state server that we talked about there before could be multiple things, right? So at the very minimum, it could be state inside the app. So up here, we could have some of the memory set aside for
built
state.
Built in that front end.
Yeah. Right. Or we could have, like you said, Mark, an out-of-band, and we could have a server over here that's just running the state. Or that server could also be leveraging a database. So there's a mix of what we can do there. And if you're familiar with ASP.NET applications from the past, you know what the state options are, right? We have in-memory, and we have out-of-band state servers, and then we have SQL database. And then also you could write custom. Before we had even the out-of-band SQL state, a lot of people were doing that to begin with just to make these things scale. But the important thing to remember is keep those transactions specific to what you're doing. Make sure we don't have a dependency on our state servers in order to make our application scale and make this application as stateless as possible. And with that concludes the topic on stateless design specific to Azure.